What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. So far, we've been enriching the sorting algorithm series with algorithms that are able to sort any type of object. But what if we needed to sort only integers, and in particular, small integers? Are these algorithms still the best choice out there? Or do we have more performant algorithms we can rely on? Well, one of these specialized algorithms goes by counting sort, and happens to be the topic of today's video. This algorithm is used to sort only integers. Why is that? Because the integers stored inside the array to sort will be used as indices, and while a string, for example, cannot be used as an index. Let's take this array of 5 integers to try and understand what this algorithm is all about. You see, all the elements stored inside this array are actually 3 different integers, 0, 1, and 2. What this algorithm does is it will create another array of size 3, and these elements, their actual value, will now be used as the index in this new array. The value stored inside each slot of this new array and corresponding to each of these indices is the number of occurrences of the index in the initial array. So, for example, the integer 0 appears twice in the initial array. Then the value stored under index 0 in the newly created array will be 2. Number 1 also appears twice. Then the value stored under index 1 will also be 2. And finally, the 2 appears only once, then the value stored under index 2 is 1. Now, how will this new array help us with the sorting? Well, all we have to do now is iterate over this new array and print the value of index 0 twice, followed by 2 ones, and end it with a single 2. And here it is, our array is sorted. Now, this was a very simple example just to showcase the counting sort algorithm. Let's take another array, where things might get a little bit trickier. You see, in this array, we have negative values, and negative values cannot be used as indices. So what are we going to do? How are we going to solve this? Well, this problem, and many others, can be solved by assigning the 0 index to the smallest value stored inside our initial array, or the minimum value, always, whatever the case is. So in this array, the minimum value is minus 2, and the maximum value is 7. So we are going to create an array that can hold 10 slots in total, and index 0 will store the number of occurrences of the minus 2, whereas index 9, which is the highest index, will store the number of occurrences of integer 7. But why 10 slots, not 9 then? Well, we have a slot for minus 2, another for minus 1, that is 2 slots, 7 slots from 1 to 7, so that's 9 slots, and do not forget that between those we have the 0, and that sums up to 10. The corresponding slots inside each array are bound to each other by the formula value minus the minimum is equal to the index. Let's take integer 5 as an example. To find its corresponding array slot, we can do 5 minus minus 2, which is 7. Then go to the slot with index 7 in the newly created array and increment the value there. This informs us that value 5 turns up once in the array we want sorted. The same process is then repeated for each element stored inside the array we want to sort, leading us to an array very similar to the one we had in the easier example at the beginning. After we do this, and similarly to what we did before, we have to iterate over the array holding the count for each of the integers to obtain our final sorted array. Now let's try to implement, together, this sorting algorithm. Concerning the class definition and constructor, they look very similar to our previous sorting algorithms. However, this time, we cannot make the class generic, as the counting sort algorithm cannot be used on any type of objects, but only on integers. Therefore, the array passed to the constructor, or the array we want sorted, will be restricted to an array of integers. For the sort method, you can choose to pass the minimum and maximum values as arguments to it, or you can retrieve them yourself using a simple min or max function. In our case, we will be going with the latter to keep our method definition as concise as possible. Inside the sort method, we went ahead and retrieved the minimum and maximum values using the stream's API max and min functions. Now that our minimum and maximum are calculated, we can start with the actual algorithm. The first thing we did, back in our example, was create the array that will store the occurrences of each of the values present in the array we want to sort. This is done using the new keyword. The number of elements this array should hold is max minus min plus 1. Remember, we previously had a minimum of minus 2 and a maximum of 7, and for those we had to create an array with 10 slots. So this plus 1 is to hold the 0 index if you want. Next, we want to iterate over the array we need to sort. And for each value stored inside this array, we have to subtract the minimum from it. The result of this subtraction, as we already mentioned, is the index referencing the slot in the array we just created. The value stored or referenced by this index, which should be 0 when we start iterating, has to be incremented for each element we calculated. Now, after counting the number of occurrences, what we have to do is loop over the newly created array storing these occurrences. And this, of course, is done using a for loop, starting at 0 and going all the way till max minus min plus 1, which is the maximum length of the array. Now, while the number of occurrences stored inside each slot is still different or bigger than 0, we have to store the index referencing the slot inside the initial array in its final sorted position. However, before storing it, we have to add the minimum to it, as to create this index, we previously subtracted the minimum from the value we had. Of course, the number of occurrences will then have to be decremented, or we would be creating an infinite while loop. Additionally, the initial array index counter we created will have to be incremented. This allows us to store the next integer we iterate on, next to the one we just stored. And there you have it, the counting sort algorithm. Let's create a main method and test what we just implemented. In this method, I went ahead and created an array holding integers, as you can see. I also printed out the initial state of this array, how these integers are placed inside the array before we perform any kind of sorting. After we call the sort method and print the resulting array to the console, you can see that the array is now sorted in ascending order. If you wanted to sort the array in descending order, all you have to do is reverse the direction of the second for loop, the one that is iterating over the newly created array storing the number of occurrences, as you can see in front of you. Okay, now in the second part of this video, I want to show you another way to implement the counting sort algorithm. Because you see, you may stumble upon any of these implementations, and I want you to understand what is happening in either cases. The very first part of this implementation is exactly the same, nothing changes. We will iterate over the initial array we want to sort and count the occurrences of each value stored inside this array. These occurrences will then be stored in a newly created array that can hold max minus min plus 1 element. Now let's look back at the example we had. If we take the occurrences array and add each value stored inside this array to the one preceding it. So, index 0 will remain 1, but the value of index 1 will be whatever was stored in index 1 plus the value of index 0, and so on. You may have noticed here that the index that induces a change from a slot to another is actually the value that is present inside our initial array. So in our example, the recurring 1s switch to a 3 at index 4, which corresponds to the value 2, and the value 5 switches to a 6 at index 9, which corresponds to the value 7 stored inside our initial array. But what we've done here is not only limited to this, it reaches far beyond that. The value stored inside this array does not represent the number of occurrences anymore, but instead represents the actual final index or final position of this value inside the sorted array. Let's think about it. The minimum value is always positioned at index 0. Hence, we'll always have the smallest value and will be positioned at the very first place in the initial sorted array. Whereas the last element and the biggest one will always be positioned at the very end of this array. And you can see that the value stored inside the slot is equal to the length of our initial array representing the highest slot where it should be stored. But why is that? Why have we obtained the final index when we did this? Well, it is because the numbers that were stored and were added are the occurrences. So in our example, the minus 2 had an occurrence of 1, and the 2 an occurrence of 2. Then if we add 2 and 1, we will obtain 3. Then these values will take 3 slots in the sorted array, and the value that will come next in the sorted array has to take slot number 4, which in our case is the value 4. Now, after doing this, all we have to do is iterate over our initial array and map each value stored inside this array to its corresponding final index using the array we created. In code, adding each value to the one preceding it is pretty straightforward. All you have to do is loop over our newly created array and add to the value stored in the I index the value in the I minus 1 index. Now, in the next step, because we are actually looping over the elements of our initial array, hence we cannot alter these elements, we will have to create another array having the same length as the initial one. This array will be used to store the stored values. Inside this for loop, we will retrieve the current element we are standing at, then we are going to calculate the final index of this element. First, we go to the slot it is referenced by, using the value minus minimum formula we are already used to. Then we have to subtract 1 from the value we retrieve. Why do we do that? Because, if you recall the example we just had, the minus 2 had a position of 1. So the positions stored inside the array start at 1, whereas the actual indices we have here start at 0. Therefore, to take this into consideration, we have to subtract 1 from the overall result. Next, what we have to do is put the value we have inside the output array we created using the final index we just retrieved. And finally, we have to decrement the position stored inside the occurrences array we have to take into consideration the frequency of each of these values. When we are done with this for loop, the remaining step to do is copy the output array to the initial array because, well, our target was to sort that array in the end. To do this, you can use the traditional for loop way or you can use the system.arrayCopy method. As you may have guessed, this implementation will generate the same output in the main function we had and will also sort the array of integers you provided with in an ascending manner. Now, before ending the video, I want to tell you about one downside of the counting sort algorithm as a whole, regardless if you choose to go with the first or the second implementation that we covered. The performance of this algorithm relies on the difference between the maximum and the minimum, because based on this difference, we are going to create our occurrences array. So if the array we want to sort looks something like this, the occurrences array will consist of 1,000 slots, and we will have to iterate over every single slot to sort this array, whether we are using the first or the second implementation. And here, we have to do 1,000 iterations to sort 3 elements only. That's bad, right? But everything has a solution. And I will actually address this problem in the next video of this series, the radix sort algorithm. So that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.